Okay, well, that should be the conclusion of our show tonight. In terms of the live performance on stage, they are standing as if a troop of actors out on the stage taking the bows. John Scherer is here, and John...
No, he's not.
I understand there are a few tickets left for the late show in case people who have heard the show would like to journey out to the Capitol.
Yes, there's some good seats also left at
okay.
this point.
Some real good seats. And the show starts when?
At 10:30. And we should probably be a little bit late because of the broadcast and some other things.
And the show opens with Steve Forbert and then goes on to Hart, obviously. Okay, great. Thank you, John.
You did that well, Richard. Thank you.
Thank you very much. John is wearing a work shirt here. And, I mean, he really looks like one of the people, except it's got the Bill Blass sticker on it, which...
Richard is in a $250 PR Cardan.
Ann Wilson has just come back, and she's going to talk to us briefly here. Wow. You look tired. I guess you are. And Nancy has just come back, too. Okay, this is the first show you've done in a while now. This is the first leg of the tour.
Yeah, we. This is the first show we've done in a month. So.
And you were in New York. In fact, I met you. I don't know if you remember back at the Palladium dates at JP's after the show. You don't remember. Okay. Long time ago. It was probably all of 2 months. Okay. One of the things I really was curious about is there aren't really too many rock and roll performers from the Seattle, Vancouver area. I mean, who is from there? Did you have any precedents or antecedents
Whalers.
That you remember?
Well, the Whalers.
Jimi Hendrix?
Yeah, Jimmy was born and raised there, but he kind of made it out of England, you know. But he's a Seattle boy.
So you really had no kind of models from the area to follow. So it seems to me, just listening, that your music's influenced by British people like Led Zeppelin.
Yeah, but I'd say when we were younger, we listened to other British people besides them. We used to listen to the Beatles a lot and the Stones. And excuse me if I'm a little out of breath, folks. But I'm in this group, and I just played this concert, I guess. So.
So you have a right. But, I mean, what kind of music did you really listen to there growing up?
Beatles and Stones and stuff.
Almost all the English invaders, you know. We were very into the English rock scene, and some of the American people, too, like Paul Simon. And but mostly, you know, British groups. Mm-hmm. And still to this day.
You'll have to excuse me for covering ground. I know you've probably talked about it in interviews before, but this is like your first time on the air in New York. So a lot of people listening probably don't know a lot of the background of the band Hart. When you had your first album, which was on a small label, Mushroom Records, I mean, what did you think would happen? Did you, in your wildest dreams, anticipate it being a platinum album and doing as well as it did?
No, no way. I mean, I just thought, I really questioned why everybody was so, at the label, was so worked up about it, you know. I mean, I liked it myself, but I didn't think that it was the kind of thing that was going to get popular, you know. That's what I mean to say. And like, they used to come in while we were working on the album and say, oh, it's going to sell a million, and I'd say, oh, come on, be real, you know.
Not our first album. Nobody's first album ever does that.
But in retrospect, why do you think it did do so well?
Well, it's a pretty unique type thing. I mean, people, like, there's room for something in people's lives, like Hart, you know, like a mellow side and a hard rock side. And
yeah, our music isn't super predictable, you know. It's kind of different levels of things, and everything from real hard rock to real emotional kind of music.
Yeah, also, there aren't too many groups that have two women in them, you know, fronting the group, and that kind of added a novelty to it.
Those comparisons, I know in the early days you were happening just as Fleetwood Mac started to break. Did the comparisons everybody was making, well, Hart, Fleetwood Mac, it's two women in front, did that disturb you at all?
We're getting used to being compared with everything and everybody, you know. It's everyone has their own idea about what Hart is and isn't, and I think Hart's something pretty unique in its own right, but people always have to make comparisons with everything, like Ann and Grace Slick, Ann and Janis Joplin, Ann and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, you know. It always happens to us, so we're used to it now.
Yeah, I think it's starting to wear off, though. I think people are starting to realize that we are Hart and nothing else. And also, as the band has come along, it's evolving into its own you know, more and more original and unique essence, you know.
You know, new female vocalists, people are comparing them to Ann Wilson, you know, it's the same idea carried through.
One of the things very untypical is that your records, you have included live cuts on your studio albums, like Dog and Butterfly has a couple live tracks on it, and the infamous Magazine album has some live things on it. So it's not as if you can just, you know, put on a hard album and expect to hear, you know, an entire side of studio. You know, there is some live music on it, too. Would you ever release a totally live album? Have you thought of that?
Yeah, someday we will. There's been a lot of, in all our fan mail, there's been a lot of outcry for that, and I think we will. We haven't started to accumulate the tapes yet, though. You don't just tape one show and you know, release it as a live album.
One of the things I've wondered about, just in terms of role models, you know, people that you listened to earlier, on stage, you know, most female vocalists on stage have been very subdued and, you know, laid back, and they don't move around a lot is what I'm trying to say. And you're very animated. I mean, you're just, you know, all over the stage. Do you get that from watching male performers? I mean, you know, where does all that come from?
Yeah, well, I get that from watching male performers, and also just from my own exuberance on stage. I get kind of set free on on stage, you know, and I think we all do, and God, I could no more stand still than fly to the moon, you know? Like, the people that I watched that I liked were like Paul McCartney and Rod Stewart and guys like that who flail. Well, Paul doesn't so much, but Rod Stewart really flails, you know? And that turns me on to watch that, you know? I think that's cool.
Well, Nancy, you're more subdued on stage. I mean, you're more what we have maybe in a chauvinistic way expected from ladies on stage. You know, you're more laid back. Are you two like that in real life? I mean, are you the quieter one, and Anne is the more extroverted, or is it a role reversal?
No, I think we really are like that. Thanks. But I think my kind of where I have my forte is musically. And, of course, being the vocalist, people notice the vocals the most. And my kind of activity is more subtle, but it's still there. I still jump around, and I still, musically, I put forth a lot of energy. But it's not the vocal thing that catches all the attention.
So it's not really like a sibling rivalry. You two aren't really kind of both bumping for the spotlight. You're both content in the
Definitely
roles that you've chosen.
Definitely not.
I'll scratch your eyes out.
No, I think Ann Wilson, my sister,
is
unequaled as a singer. And I never could, you know, even dream of taking that place. But musically, I have my strength. And I would like to sing more sometime, you know, but it's a matter of writing the right song for that. But as it is, you know, it's everyone's doing what they're best at doing, and that's how it should be.
This is a question you've both probably been asked countless times, but, you know, I feel obligated to ask it just having you here. Two women fronting a band in the music business, you must acquire a lot of chauvinism and people kind of not taking you seriously as musicians because of your sex. Do you find that? How do you deal with it?
Well, I think that we haven't encountered much, call it male chauvinism, that's gotten in our way. We have encountered some chauvinism that's opened doors for us, you know, like, not open doors, but I mean, like, we've encountered a lot of chauvinism, like, send them back flowers, be nice to them, you know.
Yeah, right, and they're fragile.
Take it easy on them, you know, and,
That's all right.
And that's fine with us, you know, I mean.
Do you have men? Like, I noticed for a change at the Capitol, usually there are women in the front, you know, yelling and waving, but I saw men tonight. I mean, how do you deal with that? I guess I'm saying, are there groupies? I mean, what do you do?
Well, yeah, we get lots of men, and it's fine as long as they don't decide they're going to come up on stage and say hello, you know, like I did tonight.
We couldn't tell. I mean, what exactly happened tonight? Because we were watching back here, and we saw something going on, but we weren't sure.
Yeah. Well, I was just kind of standing there on stage, and all of a sudden, there's this guy that was rushing toward me saying, "Oh, come on here, let me kiss you, come on." And you could tell that he meant well, you know. I mean, he was just this guy that was just overcome with his emotion, you know, and he wanted to come up and say hi to Anne. But
marry me, Anne.
Come on, Anne. But, like, you can't really have that because you never know who's going to do what. And so the guys had to hustle him off. But the poor guy, that was probably the dumbest decision he ever made, was to come up on stage,
because he didn't get to see the rest of the show.
He got tossed in the street, you know. But yeah, there are groupies around, you know. I mean, we're not, Nancy and I aren't necessarily into that, you know. I mean, sex with strangers, but
we're pretty,
but they're available, and a lot of them are men and a lot of them are women, you know.
We're pretty old-fashioned. We're pretty old-fashioned girls, you know, in our attitudes about that. I think that's still the male rock and roll male trip that goes on, but I don't see that much place for it for females, you know.
Yeah.
At least for us.
Yeah, well, you know, like nowadays most of the groupies go to the roadies anyway. It's changing, you know.
Yeah. Just along those lines, I mean, obviously, as attractive ladies, there must be other things aside from rock and roll in your life. I mean, have movie offers or things like that come your way, and what do you think about it? Do you think there's maybe a future as, you know, acting or something like that?
Well, gee. Well, you know, I've had a couple of...
this contract in my pocket.
Just sign here.
Well, I've had a couple of movie offers. I've turned a couple of them down, and there's one that I'm considering right now for the film American Pop by Bakshi, who did Lord of the Rings.
Right.
But I'm not sure about that yet. You know, I have to make sure it's a something that that I could really get my teeth into, you know.
Yeah. I've
never acted before, by the way. I really don't know, you know, whether I'd even be capable of doing it.
But she's a natural, though. She'd be able to do it, no problem.
What about you?
Oh, you know, I'll just have a bit part. I'll just be one of the hippie flower girls in the background who walks by.
No, just wait.
Oh no, well, you're.
Look, I'm pouring.
I think you're more of a natural acting than I am, but I would love to be just in a movie, you know, just as a not a real heavy duty part, just something fun, you know, one of the extras, you know. But we're doing an animated film right now for our song Mistral Wind, which is really fun, interesting, and exciting thing to do for us.
Well, you know, I found listening to that the first time reminding me of Led Zeppelin's Kashmir, and then when you did...
that's a compliment.
Well, yeah, I mean, with the phase drums and the way it builds up like that. And you did Rock and Roll as one of your encores.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's why I guess the natural association arose in a lot of people's minds, I suppose. One final question, because I know you're tired and you have a late show to do, but... technologically on the horizon, video discs are being talked about. What do you think about that? How do you conceive of heart being presented in a visual fashion as well as oral on video discs?
Oh, I think that's an incredible expansion of the media, you know, and like it's going to happen no matter what anybody says, because it's already happening, you know. And it's going to be those groups that can make, like when they changed from silent movies to talkies, you know, it'll be those groups that can make the change that are going to be the big stars of tomorrow, you know. And I can see us making the change, because we're people that are into heart as a visual thing, dress, you know.
You know, all your effects on stage with the dried ice and the pan pots.
And God, there's just unlimited possibilities
for that. More effects are being used tonight, too.
Mm. Yeah.
That's really an exciting possibility. Where do you go from here? I understand you're going to Boston and doing a regional broadcast, which won't be carried in New York, because we're doing this tonight, obviously.
It's a national broadcast.
Oh, it's national tomorrow
night.
You're
going to hear it on the West Coast.
Oh, great. Terrific. So then this is a 20-city tour, and then I suppose you go back and maybe write some and do a studio album?
Yeah, right. We're on our way to, hopefully, our masterpiece album.
The title, or is that what you think is going
to
happen?
Hey, that's a good title. Well, you know, that's just our big ideal dream, you know, is to make the album. So we always try with each album to make that be it, you know, and we're trying again this time.
Yeah. What about the magazine now? That's out in the stores, and I mean, how do you feel about that record? Do you care if people buy it? Are you proud of it? Do you just, it's there and.
There's some really good songs on the album, and mm-hmm. and some other, like the live material was done in a club in Seattle way before we'd ever played a concert. So some of it represents Heart, and some of it doesn't. So we have mixed feelings about it, but we never thought it totally represented us, and we didn't get to do it the way we wanted to, but it's all over with now, so it's, in retrospect, it's okay by us.
Yeah, the four songs, Heartless, Devil Delight, and Magazine, and just The Wine, I really like, and the song, yeah. Here Song, I really like.
Me too.
It's just all the filler stuff that they threw on there that, yeah. that leaves me cold.
Would have made a great EP, right,
yeah.
or something like that.
Exactly, but isn't it? To say that at the time, you know. Why not?
Okay, well, thanks for coming by. I know you want to probably take a rest, and we enjoy it, and we'll talk to you later, and,
sure.
and thanks for coming by. Okay, Ann and Nancy Wilson from Heart, and we just saw a real exciting concert. We'll go back to the studios after we give thanks to a lot of people, all the folks at Portrait Records, Walter Winnick, and the folks at Epic Records here in New York, and Mel Karmazin and Scott Muni helped put the broadcast together. Tom Drucki, who is the technical director at the Capitol Theater, and John Scher and all his staff and management for making our stay here very comfortable. Our executive producer tonight was Pat Dawson. Our broadcast engineer was Mitch Katz. Production was technically directed and mixed by David Vander Hayden, assisted by Michael Flicker, who is Heart's producer in the studio, who helped David mix the show and really put things together. Michael especially for all the help. And produced by yours truly for radio, Richard Neer.